When we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, belief arose. And belief engaged with belief. And it's that belief engaging with belief that we call existence. And this belief engaging with belief gave rise to what we believe is our identity. But it's not. We're prior to belief. Belief is the great bully, the great liar, the great deceiver from the very beginning. And it tells us that there is a way to change reality. There is a way for us to be prime creator. That's a lie. That's a falsity from the very beginning. Belief is nothing but a liar. All it does is lie. And it's by seeing through belief, by exposing the lies of belief, by seeing it, you then start to disengage from belief. Belief is always engaged with belief, but spirit is engaged with belief by wanting what belief offers, believes it can offer us. So as long as we want, desire what belief believes it can offer to us, we will find ourselves engaged with belief. The problem with what is to come in this world, in the near future of this planet, is that it's designed to get us to engage even more deeply with belief, which is a very, very, very unwelcome kind of development for anybody. Most definitely, the spiritual path is to disengage from belief. Disengage from what belief believes it can offer us. Because it cannot offer us anything. Zero. So the times are so pivotal because we're coming up upon this pivotal time where we either decide to disengage from belief or to engage even more tightly and deeply with belief, which will lead to nothing but the most regretful misery and delay. So it's all important right now to continue this process of disengaging from belief, and that is what I have been doing, and what everyone who's on the spiritual path, a true path of salvation, has been doing. Now, there are two plans for salvation. One of them works, one of them doesn't work. As you might expect, belief has a plan for salvation, and it believes in its plan of salvation. Its plan of salvation doesn't work. It tells us that it will succeed in changing reality for us, and that will be our salvation. Once we manage to develop a power that can threaten reality, then we'll force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. Belief believes that this will take place. So it tells us to just follow along with the scenario that belief keeps laying out, and that'll result in our salvation. In other words, keep engaging with the belief in belief. And what it believes it can offer us, keep believing in that, keep engaging with it, keep desiring that. That's the false plan of salvation. And exposing that and seeing it as it is, what it is, and the falsity of it helps us, you know, lessen our desire for it. We say, there's nothing there. We don't really want that. So we are engaged in looking at what we don't really want and seeing that we don't really want it, seeing how we're being intimidated by belief. Belief is very intimidating because it believes that it knows, but it doesn't know, it only believes. The prime creator did not create creation to believe in creation, but to know, to be, is one perfect knowing of creation. There's no need for any belief in creation whatsoever. Prime Creator did not create belief. So what we really want is reality, the way that it is. And belief really offers us nothing, nothing at all. But it believes that it can offer us something better than reality. So belief, believing in belief, is the great liar. It is a great bully. And it's totally convinced that it's right. And so it will tell you things that are completely wrong. And it'll be difficult to brush it aside because there's just this air of certainty about it, you know. But it's just belief. Okay, and the Prime Creator did not create belief. You know that it's not knowing. It's not knowing. When belief talks, it's not coming from a standpoint of knowing. It's coming from a standpoint of believing. Believing that if it believes something is true, then its belief must be true. It must be so. So when it tells you, don't do this, you know, don't go beyond belief, it believes that this is true. And all the dangers that it tells you will happen, all the terrible things, it believes that all that is true. And since it believes it's true, it has no other reference except for belief. So it tells you as if it were true. And you say, wait a minute, you know, it doesn't add up. I look at this situation and it's just full of holes. It doesn't add up. But belief is convinced that it is right and what it believes in is true, convinced of it. So it will tell you all these lies about if you go beyond belief, what will happen? Oh, you'll be bullied, you know. It projects its own, what it does to us, and projects it on what is beyond belief. It projects it on reality. So it will claim that you're going to be severely bullied. You're going to be severely ostracized. You're going to be lied to. You're not going to be accepted. You're going to be put down. You're going to be dispirited. You're going to die. All these things that belief believes that this is what's going to happen to us when we go beyond belief. And so it warns us and saying, no, don't go there. Don't go there. It's too way, you'll hate it. It'll be terrible. Does belief know this to be true? No. It's merely referencing belief. And it believes that this is all true. So it guides us as if it were. And that is the difficulty on the path is you know, what guidance do you trust? It's the fundamental issue. Belief is the fundamental issue, the basic issue. And the way that both through this assurance and certainty that going beyond belief will be terrible for us, that we kind of hesitate and we say, wow, here's someone who really is certain that it's going to be terrible. And then if we start asking, well, why is it terrible? You know, are you sure? Because we have those who have told us it's not terrible. And so there is this kind of, you get into this dilemma. Who do you trust? Who do you believe? Or not who do you believe? Do you choose belief or do you choose knowing? Because there are those who know that going beyond belief is wonderful. Whereas belief, it believes that it's certainly going to be terrible. And we're kind of caught between trying to determine which of these is true. Which of these is true? And so it requires the ability to carefully assess the situation and do some assessment of it, because there's a lot of doubt and a lot of uncertainty because belief is so adamant about its position being right and will poo-poo any suggestion that it's not. It'll laugh at you, snicker at you, poo-poo you, at like you silly boy or you silly girl, you know, just... You don't really know what's going on at all. Or you don't understand. You don't understand these things, and it will kind of ridicule you and make you feel, you know, really uncertain, very uncertain about, you know, which way to go. That's its game. That's its game. Treat you like you're a child, as if you can't possibly be aware of why its guidance is why it's certain about its guidance, and how foolish of you to not trust it entirely, and tell you, well, you have to grow. There's a lot of growth you need to undergo. You have a lot of work to do on the spiritual path. It will tell you things like that. You have a lot of potential. It'll say, well, you've got a lot of potential, but you've got a ways to go to realize that potential. Meaning, it says you have potential to understand how right belief is, but you have a long ways to go before you finally, you know, somehow get that understanding. So it's a great bluffer. Belief is an extreme bluffer. That's all it is bluff. That's all it is. And we'll just flip-flop things and whatever it is that you can't stand about belief, it'll project that onto reality and say that's what you're going to experience there, as if you're not experiencing it here, as if it's reality that's somehow leaking into belief and causing that problem. So the spiritual path is difficult. It is difficult. Most don't realize how difficult it is because they're still working within belief. They accept the belief in the God of belief, the God that belief believes in. They accept that. They accept all the spiritual bromides that belief believes in. Belief has this entire, belief system. And it believes in the belief system, and it tells us that out of this belief system is going to come something that is better than what we really want. And we just don't understand, because it'll be transcendent of reality. Okay. All of that is 100% lies. No truth to it whatsoever. But it's very apparent that for most of the time we struggle on the spiritual path. We're struggling within belief, just trying to find the answer within belief. Like, for instance, in the profession of faith, like in the Catholic Church, we say, I believe in one God. I say, stop right there. Whoa, stop. What is this I believe? I believe in God? I believe in one God? What is that? You should say, I know one God. I know oneness. That is God. I know the oneness that is God. Not I believe. As soon as you say I believe, you are accepting a belief system. God did not, the prime creator did not create belief systems. Did not. Created knowing, perfect knowing, direct knowing. So, the whole system here in existence itself is a belief system. That's all that it is. And the struggle is that we are working within this belief system, trying to find the answer within this belief system, within belief. We say we need something, we want something to believe in. Okay. I believe in God. People say, I believe this, I believe that. I want something to believe in. That is the problem. We are, and when we try to leave the belief system, we get this dweller on the threshold situation where belief just warns you against doing it, saying you're really going to fall off the edge of the world and into the bottomless pit of endless suffering. And it believes what it's saying, with great assurance. It tells you these things as if it's doing you a great favor. That's your best friend. And everything it's telling you is a lie. And it's causes reluctance to go beyond belief and to experience the great support that is beyond belief. So it is truly a very, very sticky situation. It's like the tar baby, the story. There's some babies all dressed up in baby clothes, and someone picks up this baby and says, oh, how adorable it is, a wonderful baby. And they don't realize that this actually made of tar. And this baby sticks to you, sticks to you here, sticks to you there, sticks to you there. And you can't get rid of this baby. The baby is the baby of belief. And it's very sticky and very tricky and very unnerving and very assured, arrogantly assured that it is correct. That advice that it's giving you is the right advice. So the fact is, it's the wrong advice. Going beyond time, going beyond belief is the right advice. And very few have done it simply because they want to hedge their bets and say, well, I don't want to, say that belief is totally wrong, 100% wrong. I want to at least have, belief working for me somewhat. So I need to, try and see if I cannot satisfy what belief is saying and go along with his advice and at the same time get something I really want too. And so we try to have our cake and eat it too, is the problem. It doesn't work. It does not work. And that's just normal, absolutely normal. It's what I do. It's what everybody does. Is the uncertainty causes us to try to fashion a compromise between belief and knowing, between time and eternal nowness, isness, between the false identity and true identity. There is no identity in existence, none whatsoever. There's only a belief in identity. There's no real identity. There's no person or identity in the dream experiencing this dream, experiencing existence at all. No one. There's only spirit desiring this scenario to arise. That's it. But they're not any separate people, beings, entities, or whatever, experiencing anything. It's actually belief that believes there are all these entities and identities experiencing stuff, but there actually isn't. But that's how strong belief is. Belief has been generating all of this for a long time. This play of belief, the dance of belief, is the dance of Maya. Dance of duality is only a dance of belief with no truth to it, zero truth to it. So, how to get past this, you know, bully that tells you, don't look over there. Those over there, look how terrible they are over there. They're gonna treat you like dirt. They're not gonna accept you at all. How can you, don't go over there, you're really going to be mistreated terribly, you know. And belief is saying, I'm doing this, I'm telling you this for your own good, you know, I'm telling this for your own good. And how do you simply just brush that aside, you know, and don't engage with it? Because belief is a ferocious arguer and debater, and because it's sure of its position, but its position is only belief. And belief at its root is the denial of reality, which is meaning that reality can be changed. That's the denial of reality means that reality can be changed. That's what it is. And that's what belief is. That's all that it is this denial of reality, belief that reality can be changed. That's all that it is. And since that's false, everything that arises from belief is false as well. There's no truth to belief whatsoever. None. Zero. So what I'm seeing is that once you see through belief and realize there's nothing there, what belief does then is it projects all the badness onto, you know, reality and how you're going to be treated there, how you're going to be mistreated there, and insists that you're a neophyte, you're a low person on the totem pole. You're going to really be treated like you're nothing there. And you're going to be harassed, you're going to be attacked, you're going to be an interloper, a newcomer, and all these terrible things that actually belief brings to belief. It projects that and says reality is going to mistreat you in all these terrible ways. And so that causes us to shake and tremble with fear, like, oh my gosh, I don't want to be... You know, it's true that I am, you know, very like a newborn, you know, very inexperienced, as it were, to truth. It's been a long time since we've known, you know, known isness, our identity. So we'll feel like this is kind of like reacquainting, very new and fresh and like a freshman. And we think, you know, we're going to get hazing. We're going to get treated like we're, you know, we got like slaves, servants, and we have this fear of what's going to happen. What is going to happen when we go past belief, you know? That is the fear. But the better we can diagnose what the fear is, the better off we are, for sure. Absolutely for sure. Because then we can at least assess this, whether this is true or not. We start doing very focused assessments. Once we have it under the microscope, once we focus in and say, aha, this is what we're really afraid of. We're afraid just being, you know, treated with utmost disdain and no friendship and all this kind of thing. And then we go about and we can assess it. And that is actual progress. If you want to know what progress on the spiritual path is, that is progress. Assessing the... What belief is saying, and then what we feel we know and trying to determine, you know, which is it, which is right, which one is telling us the truth. Are we just is our knowing really out of whack and off target, or is belief trying to intimidate us and bully us and to prevent us from going beyond belief? Because belief knows once we go beyond belief and find out everything's fine, then the lie is up, the jig is up. What can belief do at that point? Nothing. It'll lose its hold upon you. Absolutely, 100% lose its hold upon you. So it is desperate to just throw up every lie possible. Which it does, which it absolutely does. And I've experienced this directly just last night. Exactly what happened. And this is what hits everybody when they're struggling to get free of belief, saying, you know what, this situation is bad, I want to get free of it. You get hit by this bad advice that insists that it knows better than you know, and it's doing it for your own good. And it does halt us in our steps. You know, if anybody comes out to us or walking along, someone suddenly rushes up shrieking to us, you know, and screams, you know, stop, 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 right there, don't go any further. My gosh, there's a terrible trap right in front of you. You're going to fall in and you know, just acts like they're convinced of it. It's going to halt your steps, right? That's what happens. That's literally what happens. So knowing this, you're going to be kinder to yourself. And a little more patient and a little more focus, because you realize just what you're up against. You're up against this, that type of determined approach, like a hysterical approach that just insists that you're going to do something horrible if you go beyond belief, if you go any further. And they're acting like they're, you know, willing to save you, you know, from a horrible fate. And that gives us pause. It gives us pause. So we can just look at that and say, yeah, it does give us pause. It has given us pause. And that's the real reason why we've paused for so long. And everybody else is pausing because of that plausibility, you know, that belief has. Belief has a whole logic of plausibility, meaning it simply believes in belief, that whatever belief believes in will become true. Even if it's not true now, it will become true. So it just simply, and since it will become true, then belief says, well, it must be true. And if it is true, then it must be true now. It's just kind of an insane type of logic. Logic of plausibility is very shifty and slippery. And so we wonder, wow, why is someone so solicitous about our well-being and is so insistent that it has something vastly important to tell us, when what we know is that it's going to be fine. Going beyond belief is wonderful. So what is the problem? What am I not seeing? That's what we think. Well, maybe I'm not seeing something. What am I not seeing here? Because belief is certain that it's seeing something, danger, right? And we're not seeing it. So we halt and pause and say, okay, wow, maybe I'm missing something here. So to go beyond belief, one has to get past that pause. Hit the play button instead of the pause button, you know. Take it off pause. And it's really difficult for most of us. It's very difficult because we're kind of in the back of our minds are saying, you know, is there some danger there? You know, I'm not sure, but it's somewhere. We know there's some feeling of danger somewhere. The danger is to believe in belief, is to continue to take the advice of belief. That's the danger. There's real danger, not real danger, but there is danger there to engaging more fully and deeply with belief, and the danger means suffering, misery, delay, depression, confusion, horrible stuff that belief brings everyone. The danger is to engage in that more fully and more deeply. That is, you know, suffering, worse suffering, longer suffering, so we can talk about that as a danger. It's not a threat to reality, because what is real cannot be threatened, but it is a danger to your peace of mind, as it were. Your true peace of mind cannot be touched. It's there. It's always there right now. But we can speak as if our unawareness of this fact, it brings us a lack of peace of mind, and that can be intensified and prolonged, and we don't want to prolong it or intensify it. So when I say those who have gone beyond belief need to step up in the world right now, that is very true. Because we need to see, hey, it's fine. The attitudes, if belief keeps things churning like a boiling pot, a boiling stew is really boiling. Everything changes all the time. So belief says, didn't used to be so bad, but now, wow, it's really terrible. You know, the attitudes of reality has really changed. And we can reference, you know, those in the past who have gone beyond belief. We say, they said it's fine. And belief will say, well, you know, maybe back then it was, but not anymore. Because look at all the change that's happened. And that kind of halts us like, whoa. Yeah, I mean, things have really changed a lot. But the truth is, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Nothing has really changed at all. The basic situation hasn't changed one iota. It's kind of like when you're boiling a soup. The pan hasn't changed. The stovetop hasn't changed. The fire or the heat hasn't changed. The lid hasn't changed. The spoon you stir it with hasn't changed. The room, the kitchen hasn't changed. The house hasn't changed. You, the cook, hasn't changed. The lighting in the kitchen hasn't changed. The air, you know, all that stuff hasn't changed at all. It's just within the confines of the pan, the soup is boiling. And it's roiling, and everything seems to be changing all the time. You know, the heat's the same. So everything's the same. It's just superficially, there seems to be all this rearranging, superficially. It's like changing a frame around a picture. Picture's the same, change the frame all the time. It doesn't change the picture at all. So the facts, the situation hasn't changed at all. But belief believes that it has. And therein lies the problem, right? Belief believes that it has changed. So whatever we bring up, we say, well, the teachers, the gurus in the past who went beyond belief, they said it's fine. And belief will look at that as a belief, not as knowing, but as a belief. And then the whole thing about belief is that belief believes it can change belief, change what is, change anything. Everything's changeable. No such thing as something that cannot be changed. So belief will just say, well, yeah, that was how it was in the past, but right now it's changed. And it will believe that it's changed. That's how it is. So it's very disconcerting, because we'll say, wait a minute, you said, yeah, it was that way in the past, and now you're saying it's not that way now. How can you, what facts do you have? And belief doesn't have any facts. It has belief. And belief believes that belief is greater than facts. Okay. Because the whole purpose is to become greater than reality. Reality is the fact, and belief believes it will become greater than reality. There's a way to become greater than reality. See, so it doesn't care about facts. It believes that facts are pedestrian, something that's going to be replaced, transcended by belief. So if we say, yeah, it's a fact that going beyond belief is fine, well, belief will just say, well, you know, you may think it's a fact. You may say you know it's a fact, but it's going to change. You know, belief believes it's going to change. It's not going to always be that way. It's going to change. So it's not really a fact. Belief doesn't believe it, and there aren't any facts. Doesn't believe it at all. So you have this slippery slope. It is a slippery slope. That's why it's like two steps forward, one step back, it seems like. As soon as we engage belief, we slip back again. Because belief is just poo-poos, you know, whatever we know is facts, and just say, it's so passe. You know, that's going to be all transcended. You know, look at the progress we're making. Look at all the stuff that's changing. Whatever you know to be true, that too will also pass away and change for sure. No doubt about it. And clinging to it, you know, is a stupid strategy. You need to get with this progress and get with what belief believes in. And it will just, it has this, you know, assurance that this is so. And we kind of like cower, you know, like think, oh boy, how stupid of me to put my faith in facts and trust in truth when truth is going to be superseded. You know, we feel like kind of like we're dummies, you know, wow, what we know is going to be superseded. So why do we have such attachment to it? We see our attachment to reality as some kind of weakness, some kind of liability that we're trying to get rid of, believing that because belief is telling us it's going to be superseded and changed, and it won't be the way that it is anymore. So all of this works upon us. All of this constantly is adding up to reluctance. That's all it is. All we have is reluctance. We know the truth. We're just reluctant to accept it for all those various spurious justifications that I've been mentioning. Somehow we feel, you know, it'll give us the short end of the stick eventually. It'll turn out to be a bad decision. Just on and on and on and on and on. All this adds up to reluctance. Reluctance, reluctance, reluctance. So the task is to bring belief to task and to vet it, to truly vet belief, what it's saying, what it's believing in, by finding out where it came from and realizing it, how it must be false from its very inception, what its purpose is, realizing it's an impossible quest, it's totally futile, totally impossible, how it has to deny this, has to deny reality, deny facts. All this stuff, you see that, and you start getting better and better picture of this adversary that is really bringing about this reluctance. This is the adversary. Some call it the ego, some call it the devil, or Satan, all these various terms, duality, and it's really belief. Belief is the adversary. Because it believes it knows better than reality. Whatever we come up with, you know, experience in reality, belief will just dismiss it. Like, ah, that's silly. That's silly. Ah, belief will say, ah, there's something much better coming. You just didn't have the, you just weren't patient enough to wait for it. They'll always say that you need to wait a little longer, and then you'll see how right belief is. And if you give up on belief, you're not being fair. But consider this, how fair is it to insist that we keep trying to accomplish the impossible? How fair is that? Is that being fair to us? Because that's what belief is saying. And now it's totally unfair, isn't it? Entirely unfair to insist that we wait for nothing. Okay, how fair is that to us? How kind is that to us? It's totally totally unfair. So it's belief that is entirely unfair, and again, it projects that onto reality and claims that reality is the one that's unfair, because somehow it's advising us don't wait, and that somehow we're going to miss out on something that would be vastly greater, and we're somehow dispossessing ourselves of this greater transcendence if we accept what is right now. You see, reality is right now, always. So this is the dance of belief, with that dance of deception, and simply looking at it is how you dispel it. You dispel it simply by looking at it, carefully looking at it like that, not to the minutest detail, but the basic outline of it, seeing okay. And that's what contemplation does. You focus in and you get wind of this. Oftentimes in dreams, what happens is I have a dream, the scenario plays out in the dream, I wake up, I focus on it and say, aha, you know, that's what's holding me back. That's the reluctance there. And then during the daytime, focus on that issue. And you make progress that way, because in dreams stripped of the veneer of just, you know, functioning, the social persona, superficial persona, you tend to play out, you know, what it is that you're really doing, trying to accomplish, and then that comes up, and you'll have this struggle. You'll see something that like, wow, an issue arises, and you get up in the morning and you say, wow, that's a problem. That's something that is holding me back. Now I need to look at that during the day. So you know, as far as motivation goes, you can get it from within. The dreams are a great way to get motivation from within. Though you have problem situations in a dream. See if you can't develop insight into that. And you'll always have the reluctance is always with you. So when you become aware of the reluctance and where is it coming from, then you have something to work on. You don't always have to rely upon anything external. That can be a help, but the reluctance is already with you. And wherever you go, it's with you. So it doesn't matter where you travel to, it will be with you. It doesn't matter if you live in a palace, you know, or the finest place, wherever you go. All the reluctance is still within you. You still have it all there. Some people travel a lot just to give themselves the impression that they're leaving this reluctance behind. I guarantee you they're not. So it's far better to just stay where you are, wherever you are, if it's the right place for you. And pay attention to the reluctance and look at it and say, where is this coming from? Why am I so reluctant? What's holding me back? I seem to have this conflict going on within. Pay attention to it. There's definitely a conflict because we cannot decide between knowing and believing, and what's telling the truth. Will truth be transcended? Will it be made obsolete? Is that true? Because that's what belief believes, and we have to assess. And it eventually adds up to dismissing belief, dismissing it, not accepting its advice. That's what we're told. Eventually, it does result in that. Eventually, but it can be a very trying process. You know, the magic pill isn't out there. There's no pill that's going to get rid of. How can any pill get us to make a final determination of what to trust in and dismiss belief, entirely dismiss it and go beyond it like, oh, okay, no problem, that's wrong, it'll never be right, and we got no qualms or concerns about it. What kind of pill can do that for us? There isn't any. What kind of treatment and therapy? There isn't any. It's only our own clear seeing of it that connects the dots and says, wait a minute, this belief is really misleading, and this is why it's misleading, and this is why it seems so sure of itself, and seeing all that and say, being able to disengage from it, disengage. Habitually, we kowtow to belief, it's just because we don't want to seem to be stupid. And belief tells us that accepting reality as it is being stupid, because supposedly belief is going to transcend it. It's going to have it changed. It's going to all be changed. So why embrace that which is going to be changed, as it is? Why accept everything as it is now if it's going to be changed? That would be stupid. To be stupid. So belief believes that its plan is actually saving us from suffering. Because the belief thinks that we'll get so attached to reality if we experience it that when it changes, we won't be able to deal with it. It will just be like the most terrible suffering imaginable to the point where we get annihilated so bad. So it believes it's helping us. It believes that's preventing the suffering. All of that. My gosh. I can look at now the propaganda that belief puts out, and it's just like clear as day. And it's amazing how... what a myth it is, how belief is able to perpetuate these myths and these false values and the false use of time. with such assurance, you know, in all these fairy tales, and dresses everything up and make it seem, you know, so true and wonderful and wow, just like selling a dream. I watched a video a couple nights ago that was just the absolute epitome of a most incredible video I've ever seen. I'm not going to say what it is, because it can pull people down into spiritual romanticism easily. I was able to watch the whole thing and just nothing. I said, wow, I used to be hooked on that stuff. Spiritual romanticism, good Lord, it's amazing. The kind of false values that belief inculcate in this world, making it all seem like it's perfectly wonderful. You might say, it's a shameless liar. Belief is a shameless liar. Has no shame. No shame when it's lying. None. So, you know, we have to see through it. Because belief will not see through itself. It's shameless in its lies. So, it's up to us. In the knowing within us, and that knowing that is the guidance to, and the voice of reason, which is that's true certainty within us, to assess belief and realize it's a fraud. You know, it's a marketing, a fairy tale dream of nothing, no meaning, is a futility, suffering, misery, and yet it makes it seem, you know, it can use every prop imaginable, make it seem like, wow, this is really important what we're doing. Existence has no consequence to reality whatsoever, zero consequence. Doesn't change it, doesn't touch it, has zero consequence, nothing. Not even the tiniest consequence to reality, none, zero, nothing. So, how important is existence? It'll never have any consequence to reality. So what's the end game? What's the outcome? Et cetera, et cetera. There isn't any. It's just a aimless wandering around, really. And making, you know, movies about this wandering around as if it were something profound. As if it were something being guided by God and through God and teachers, you know, God sending teachers into the world who are, you know, helping us wander around aimlessly and telling us that's what we're supposed to do, and there's awesome great payoff at the end of it and all this kind of stuff. It's nothing but spiritual romanticism. It's all a myth of belief. There's no truth to it at all, none. And yet it can be very beguiling. That's how I was beguiled. I came into this world, and belief really believed where I should go, and for some extent, I followed belief, you see, unfortunately, which is what almost everyone does. If you don't follow belief at all, you'll be an avatar, you'll be a savior, you'll be a guru. If you don't follow belief at all, you come into this world, then you are really going to be a super saint, super guru. But the rest of us, we follow belief reluctantly, like, we're not sure, you know, this doesn't seem right, but we still, you know, go along with it with reservations. And so believed what the right situation was for me. It had a belief, oh, this is the right place for you. This is how you're going to be helped and all this stuff. What happened was I was just fed nonstop spiritual romanticism. Nonstop. The heaviest doses you can imagine. It's almost unimaginable the kind of amount of spiritual romanticism I was fed nonstop. And finally, I was able to watch this movie just a couple nights ago and just saw through the whole thing. I said, that is just 100% nonsense. Rubbish, utter rubbish. And I realized, oh my gosh, this is what I was born and raised on in my whole life, you know, is the spiritual romanticism. My gosh, it's a potent drug, as it were. And so many are caught up in that. Almost everybody get trapped by that. Because if we don't, again, we would not follow belief at all. You know, but this is like belief putting its best foot forward and spiritualizing what it's doing. And it's able to spiritualize it. But it's only spiritual romanticism. There's no truth to it at all. but it's able to, you know, make stories. Oh, it's wonderful stories about gurus and saints and sages and what they did in their lives and how they helped everybody and what they taught, and this is what they want for us. All a pack of lies. They misinterpret it, you know. They take a genuine sage or something and then completely spiritual romanticize it and lead you astray entirely. Entirely lead you astray. So no matter who comes into the world, a perfect sage, saint, avatar, guru, enlightened one can come into the world, but belief will just start spinning spiritual romanticism around them and saying, this is what they're teaching, this is what they want you to do, and, you know, romanticizing the whole thing to the utmost extent is amazing. Leaving out the hardcore facts of existence, where everything is here is just nothing but death. There's nothing but misery, suffering, impermanence, and death. Torture. It's nothing but a torture chamber, and it leaves that out, you know, entirely, you know. Like, oh, you know, how fortunate you are that God sent this teacher here to make your life happy here and stuff. And so what? No, you don't become happy until you dump belief, go beyond belief, and stop believing in its lies. That's the only way you're ever going to be happy. Not by believing in lies, not by believing that this is this death. It's not life we're engaged in. This dream is a dream of death. It's not a dream of life. It's a dream of death. The notion that somehow we can be happy, you know, within the context of this dream of death is utter rubbish. Utter rubbish. We're happy when we realize, ah, this is nothing but a dream of death, and no longer interested in dreaming that dream. You know, and choosing a different scenario, a scenario of not trying to change reality. And then we get unconditional love overlay, perfect overlay, and we abide in that. That's how we're happy. That's the only way. It's the only way. And there's nothing romantic about that. No spiritual romanticism there. Just facts. Just facts. And belief always tries to overawe you, the spiritual romanticism, overawe you with numbers and scope and scale and the grand, you know, grandiosity of architecture and buildings and temples and numbers of people and so many worlds, the bigness of the universe. It tries to overawe you with all this grandiosity. And then painting an idealized picture, you know, and it's just like, holy cow. I just realized that's what you get taught in school. That's what you get taught. That's what you get fed in your life, is this ridiculous cartoon of existence that has no bearing on existence at all. And we just believe we're supposed to wait for something that's coming. There's nothing coming in existence except more of the same. Same old, same old, same old. That's all there is. And yet always we're believing in some spiritual romantic notion that there's something, you know, grandiose, wonderful coming. That's the waiting thing. What we're waiting for is for existence to become greater, better than reality, be able to threaten realities to the extent that Prime Creator changes reality and makes us Prime Creator, which we believe will be greater than our experiencing of reality as it is right now. So that's what we're waiting for. And that will never happen. Will never happen. So we're really just waiting for nothing. And we're tired of waiting for nothing. And we expect the teachers, you know, come in the world to make this nothing happen. Make it happen, you know. So our spiritual romanticism expects those who come here who have gone beyond belief, we expect them to make us happy within belief. It's not possible. And it can never be happy within belief. Because belief believes there's nothing permanent, so your happiness will not be permanent at all. You'll feel unstable. You'll feel vulnerable. And that's not happiness. That's not what you really want. You want true stability. You want true invulnerability. You want true identity. You want true unconditional love. You want the reality, and within belief, no such thing at all. Just and belief will just string you along, saying, "Well, you're not complete yet. You're incomplete. You need to complete the self, complete the evolution, complete the integration, complete the education, complete the learning, complete the lessons." That's all it tells you over and over, and it spins out all this romanticism, you know. Beautiful portraits, watercolor or pastel portraits, and idealized locations, and here you are, and you're happy, you're dwelling in a Edenic paradise within the context of existence, within this world, etc. Just absolute rubbish. But seeing that it is not easy. When I was viewing this movie, I was saying, "Oh my gosh, unbelievable! Unbelievable!" The production quality was off the charts, off the charts. It was like a dream coming to life. Somehow they created a dream and made a movie of it. And you're saying, "Oh, it's so idealized, you know, it's unbelievable." Why? But they're seeing that it's just complete lie, total lie. Very artistically done lie, high production value lie. Complete nonsense, utter nonsense, pernicious misdirection. But high production value to it, very high production value. And you see this, you'll see it all over the place. And I thought I would be pulled into it. I thought, "Wow, this is dangerous," but it didn't do anything. And said, "Wow, you know, I've seen through that, you know, the myth, all that myth, spiritual myth, myth of spirituality." Trying to glorify existence, glorify belief. It's belief trying to glorify belief is all it is. Trying to aggrandize belief. Belief to aggrandize belief. Belief trying to give itself authority, ultimate authority. But where is it trying to get this from? It's trying to get it from us, from spirit. It's trying to get spirit to keep saying, yeah, this is what I really desired. So spirit is giving this desire to entertain this idea of wanting to be prime creator. This desire is what fuels belief. And belief keeps trying to get us to give more and more desire, more and more. And it believes if we just give 100% desire, that somehow it will become true and will become prime creator. Even if we could give 100% desire, it would be nothing more than simply entertaining an idea, which is just normal for reality, and it wouldn't make the dream true at all. But we really can't even do it 100% because we don't really want it. There's within us is the oneness of reality, and that's what we're attracted to. So we really don't want this dream, this belief system of existence. But we're just intimidated to let it go. We're fearful to let it go. We've empowered our lies to such an extent, given them so much desire. We've had so much desire for these lies to be true, that we have a real hard time accepting that they're not true. Very difficult time. Which is why we get spun off in all these spiritual escapades, spiritual romanticism. All the escapades that arise, so many that we get off track, you know. They can be very grandiose sometimes too, and we waste a lot of time chasing after rainbows, chasing after the elusive butterfly, you know, of spiritual romanticism is an elusive butterfly, and we're there was a song in the 60s, Elusive Butterfly of Love, and that's what we're all doing. We're chasing that elusive butterfly of love within belief, or what belief believes to be love, and it proves to be entirely elusive. You know, the butterfly is just, you know, we're just not sure where it's going to go next, and we're, you know, we're just constantly thinking, we almost got it, over here now, oh, it's upon there, and you know, can't quite get it, so we keep. And as we're chasing this elusive butterfly of love, it's leading us deeper and deeper, deeper down into this dark, dark forest, you know. This very dark path. We're going on this path, and eventually we look around and say, oh my gosh, where are we? And where are we? So, love is not elusive at all. It's the elusive butterfly of belief in love that is elusive. The more we chase after it, the more lost we believe we are, because we at some point we'll just look around, like, I mean, this world, just look at this world. If we have not been in inquiry in this world, if we were to really look at this world, what's going on, and see it compared to 50 years ago, or compared when I was young, it would be complete freak out. Complete freak out. We'd say, where in the world are we? I don't know where we are. You know, it's just unbelievable. The forest, you know, has become very, very dark. And we've gone into some very, very strange places now. But by doing an inquiry, you can just say, oh, no, this is just the tapestry of this belief system, this dream. And doesn't have the freak out effect at all. Living here in Silicon Valley my whole life, I've been able to be close to a lot of these changes as they first come out, and so kind of aware of it all pretty soon after, you know, and the whole kind of, it's kind of like the source of all this is bubbling up, and you see it pouring out, and it has some kind of maybe advantage to dismiss it quickly too, and which I have done. I mean, the verdict is in on technology. For me, the verdict's already in. I've seen it, been there, done that. The verdict on technology is already, you know, been read for me. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. It's a distraction. It makes things worse, not better. And it's, again, it is like chasing the elusive butterfly of love. It's all part of that. That's all that it is. And it is leading us, the world, into some very, very weird, strange places, to say the least. Places that you'll look at and you're just shuddering, you know. And that's why we don't look at it, because we don't want to get freaked out. So we just keep playing along. The spiritual path is best taken when things are not too weird. I mean, this world is nothing but weirdness, but weirdness can get really weird. I mean, very weird. And it is, you know, getting there rapidly right now. Very weird. And but if you have done the inquiry, you just look at it and just you know, waste of time. No need, nothing there. Don't even need to pay attention to it. There's no shutter effect, you know. Not much. I just say that, you know, these are just, you know, this is just this is what happens when you don't do inquiry. that's why I look at it. You know, good thing I didn't do that, you know. Good thing I did the inquiry. That's what I'll say. I just say, wow, great thing I did the inquiry. Otherwise, you know, there but by the grace of God go I. You know, you see that, and you say, wow, good thing I did the inquiry. And that's, you know, that's about as far as it goes. But if you don't do the inquiry, you think you're stuck here. You don't know how to get out, and that freaks you out. If you're in some really weird, strange place and you don't know how to get out of it, it'll freak you out. And yet if you open the door and peek in and then close the door again, you know, and say, oh boy, that room inside there is really weird, freaky. I'm not going in there. Then you go on your way and everything's okay. But if you're inside the room, you don't know where the door is, the exit, and you realize, oh my gosh, I'm in a room full of complete madness here. You know, this is too weird. It'll freak you out. So inquiry is basically recognizing that you're not in the room, you know. You're not, what you are is not within a belief system. It doesn't arise from a belief system. What you are is that desire which gives rise to the belief system. But that desire is really just desiring one idea, wanting to be prime creator, and we can choose any other idea we want. We can, you know, reality is infinite in its tapestry of experiencing, and we're just desiring this one little mad, crazy, silly, whimsical notion. That's all that gives rise to all this weirdness of belief. So we're not really in it. We're not a product of it. It has no consequence to what we are. All of this, the more one sees this, the less one is going to get freaked out by what's going on. You can just say, that's not important. It has no consequence to what I am. And therefore, just don't engage with it. Don't need to engage with it. Don't need to engage with it at all. If you're in a room of real weirdness, you don't know where the exit is, what are you going to do? You're going to start engaging with all this weirdness. Like, can you tell me where the exit is? And, you know, and you're just going to get all this crazy, weird advice. And then you just want stumbling around in desperation. How do I get out of here? Because nobody in the room knows how to get out of there. So then you tend to go, well, I don't even want to try. Let me just, you know, try to get with the weirdness, make it seem normal to me, which is what happens. I've seen so many, the whole world now is becoming extremely weird. They're trying to normalize weirdness. Everyone's trying to normalize it because you got a lot of waves of extreme weirdness coming into the world, extreme weirdness, and people don't have the tools to deal with this. They're not with inquiry. They don't recognize that what they are, you know, is not a product of belief. And therefore, what they do is they try to normalize the weirdness in their own lives by themselves, accepting the weirdness. Which just makes things actually worse. But it's understandable, true, because, you know, when you start asking people who are lost, you know, how to get out of this maze, they, you know, they're going to pretend like they know, like, oh, or are they just going to lay some weirdness on you? And you're just like, oh, man. That's like in being in Haight-Ashbury in 67. I remember going through there and driving through there, and my parents took us through and you know, slowly we're stopping and we're looking at everything, and there's all these very trippy people, same in Telegraph Avenue in Berkeley, you know, the human zoo, the weirdness. Everybody was on a trip, and everybody was into weirdness, and everybody's laying their trips on other people, like, say, hey, you know, where's it at, man? You know, and they'll say, hey, this is where it's at, let me tell you where it's at. And they lay whatever, you know, drug trip or whatever trip they were on you, and you get it from so many places. I mean, the Bay Area was absolutely saturated in weirdness, and some will say that it still is. It definitely is. I mean, the weirdness has changed, but it's still saturated with weirdness. And you get if you ask, you know, you'll get this weirdness, these weird trips laid on you. Say, here's what you need to do to feel normal. Be like, you know, they say you need to be like they are in order to be normal, because they think that they're trying to be normal, being weird is normal, and believing in belief and the objectives of belief, they believe that's normal. It's not. All this stuff is abnormal, totally abnormal, totally weird, and it's just a bunch of lostness. It's lostness trying to give guidance to lostness. It's like the blind leading the blind. It's the blind leading the blind. Fortunately, I had access to that which was not weird, and out that which realized that it was not a product of belief. And I just spent my time kind of hunkered down, paying attention to that, and not going out. I mean, I live in the Bay Area, but I don't go out into the Bay Area. You know, I don't partake in the culture of the Bay Area at all. Never have. Don't go to parties. Don't go to, you know, nightclubs. Don't go to concerts. Don't go to any culture event. I don't do anything here. I just hunker down and pay attention to that which knows the truth, which knows that its reality is not a product of the process of belief. But I realize, you know, if you want to, the Bay Area, you can have trips laid on you just instantaneously everywhere. And the trips have changed a little bit, you know. The high tech thing now is, and then the environmental thing and all this, you know, how to live thing right and you name it. And then back in the mountains, you can still get the hippie trip, and there's just almost endless trips here. The gaming trip, the nerd trip, the high tech thing. There's just a potpourri of everything you could possibly imagine can get laid on you so easy. If you just, you know, inquire, you know, ask like, hey, you know, do you have the answers, you know, and they'll say, hey, you know, sure, you know, just be like like me, you know, I'm normal. If you're like me, you'll be normal too, and everything will be fine. Nothing can be further from the truth, of course. So it is a benefit to live in the Bay Area, actually, because you're aware of all these trips. And if you can survive it, and you know, it's like, you know, it's so bad that if you can manage to see how bad it is, and you become almost immunized to it, immunized to technology, immunized to all this trippiness. They call it quote unquote diversity, you know, as if all this lostness, aimless wandering, lostless and weirdness. It just, as long as we call it diversity, then it's, you know, it's fine, it's great, we're home. You know, home in diversity. We're all home. You know, that kind of thing. We're all normal because we're all weird. Therefore, we must all be. If everyone's weird, it must be weird. Must be normal. Therefore, we can believe that is our home. We should be happy with it, which is just, you know, the logic of belief, the logic of plausibility, which is insanity. So if you can manage, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. That is true. That's usually said about New York, which is very trippy, but in a slightly different way. But the Bay Area is really like the cutting edge of all the innovation of weirdness. Okay, keeps coming out of here, coming out of here, coming out of here, nonstop. My gosh, always. It's 100 years of it. So technology, I've seen, you know, verdicts in, utter scam, blind leading the blind. It just gets you to engage ever more deeply in the delusion of belief. And it's really pathetic is what it is. It's nonstop, you know, oh my gosh, the next version, the next version, the next version. Oh, it takes pictures like this and moves the pictures like that. Oh, as if, you know, all we are is some picture monsters, you know. We have to have these pictures. I can send pictures there. I can send pictures there, and that should make us happy. Yeah, we just have a little more cleverness in pictures and multimedia and stuff that we're gonna be happy. Utter rubbish. Utter nonsense. But what a distraction! What a waste of time, you know. I did my time with all that stuff, so I know for sure it's an utter waste of time. Very bad use of time. But if you can recognize that, then that you can move beyond it. You can move beyond it. So in some ways it can be helpful. If you get caught up in that and you can get out of it, then you can just say, whoa, you know, never again. That's it. I'm that is definitely not it. But on the other hand, it can be quite dangerous if you don't have a grounding in inquiry and truth and knowing, then, you know, you can easily get swept up in this idea of somehow you have, you know, it's a spiritual manicism of it, like this is something really new. This is something new. How is belief new? How is belief believing in belief, believing in its goals? How is that new? That's been there since the beginning, since we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That's been there all along. Everything has been here all along. There's nothing new under the sun. We just present it in new ways, but it's the same. We're presenting the same old, same old. False path. You know, we're just presenting the false path in cooler ways. You know, oh, this is really cool. Look at this. Here's a false path and a real cool. Look at this, how cool that is. You know, false path and panorama. In virtual something. I mean, and the cool factor, you know, is being sold to the world. Yeah, this is cool. This is the newest thing. This is the latest thing. If you don't have that, you're behind the times. This is the advancement in coolness. There's nothing. It's just, it's basically peddling nothing at all to you. And saying, look how cool this nothing is now. You say, you didn't like the old nothing is no longer cool. Well, don't worry. We have the new version of nothing. It's even cooler. You'll be amazed at this version of nothing. Because, again, the idea that reality can be changed is nothing. It's not true. It cannot be changed at all. So what belief can give us in all this rigmarole is nothing. We'll realize that it's just simply wasted. We wasted our time. Time idly spent. That's all we will ever realize of existence. And how cool is it just, you know, time idly spent in misery and suffering and death? How cool? It's not cool. It's not cool at all. It's terrible. You know, you can take a picture of terribleness and you know, it do, you know, special effects on it. It's still, you know, terribleness. And what you took a picture of is still terrible. It doesn't matter how you doctor the picture, it's the same. So, the sooner you see through the tricks of belief, the better. And we have a great opportunity here. You can see through technology, high tech, not just now, but in all its developments, you can just recognize that it has nothing you really want whatsoever. Complete waste of time. Doesn't matter if you develop it for a million years. Doesn't make any difference. Because you can do all sorts of stuff with energy. You know, and cool stuff. Belief can do all sorts of cool stuff. Doesn't mean it can ever make us prime creator, which is what we are waiting for. Because if we couldn't be prime creator, why are we waiting? What are we waiting for? If we can, we would experience how we are right now, which is, you know, infinite delight and richness of experiencing exactly what we really want. We would just say, oh well, I'm not gonna wait around for what can ever happen. So of course we're expecting that to happen. Nothing else other than that, really. So all this cool stuff, you know, it is just a way to string us along, but it's not what we really want. We say, hey, you know, when are we going to get to the, where's the beef? Where's the beef? It hasn't shown up yet. And we keep recognizing this, like all this cool stuff. We say, you know, what is this? And just then something else comes along, and hey, you can be able to custom make all this stuff, you know, and that's really cool. And you can see that and you just say, but that's not what I really want. I want to, you know, we want to be prime creator, and we cannot be prime creator, so it's a waste of time. This whole thing is a waste of time. Not getting anywhere. Not getting anywhere. And the fact that it's a waste of time is no problem, because our default is perfect. So, you know, what do we lose? By giving up this insane quest, what do we lose? Nothing. We default into perfection. So we want to disengage as much as possible from all this meaningless scenario of existence, all this action that all this belief in consequences and outcomes. Disengage from it as much as possible prior to it all heating up really severely. Right now it's like we have a bonfire that we have all this pile of wood, like a built a bonfire, all the wood's there, and it's being lit in, you know, the tinder underneath is being lit in many lit places, many, many places, and it's just barely, you know, the flames are flickering down below, and it's low heat, low heat. But you know once you start using the bellows and pumping air into that all that tinder, suddenly will flame up and go through the whole pier of wood, this massive bonfire of wood, and it will turn into a raging fire quickly. And so right now we say, well, it's not too hot. You know, we see the potential for it to become hot. But we say, no, there's all these little hot spots around, but it hasn't, the whole, you know, the big pieces of wood, the whole thing hasn't caught fire yet, so the heat's not so bad. Sure, it's not, it's we're feeling the heat. You say, yeah, it's, but it's not overwhelming yet. But imagine if the bellows give all that oxygen to the flames below, how quickly it will heat up and catch all the big logs on fire, and then the whole thing will become a raging conflagration, and then it will become intolerably hot. And that can happen very quickly, because all the wood is there. The fuel is there for the fire, and the tinder all around has been lit already and will continue to be lit. All we need is for that, you know, strong oxygenation to take place. And the small little, you know, tinder fires will turn into a raging conflagration that will be unbearable for us if we are engaged with belief. But if we're disengaged from belief, we'll just say, ah, good thing I did inquiry. Good thing I disengaged from belief. That's all we'll say. Ah, great. Good thing I disengaged from belief. So it'll be like a positive thing, like, oh, so fortunate, that so good that I disengaged from belief. That is a wonderful thing. That's all, our reaction will just be that. Wow, great thing that we, you know, got out of Dodge, so to speak, at the right time and didn't wait too long. Those are huddled around this funeral pyre, you know, thinking it's giving them some kind of heat now. They don't realize it, that it's going to burst into this massive, you know, raging inferno. That'll be too hot for them, and then they'll be fleeing, and they'll be scorched. They'll be scorched. But if you back away from it ahead of time, then when it bursts into flame, you won't be scorched. You'll just say, good thing I backed away in time. Which is doing inquiry. That is how you back away from it. You disengage from belief. Disengage from belief. And simultaneously you're engaging with reality, with unconditional love, with the I am presence of isness, with reality, with that perfect steadiness and calmness. You're engaging with that. You're making, you're starting to clarify the decision, like,